Hi, let's look at the Azure DP201 real exam questions. This is the part 2 of the video. This topic covers mostly designing Azure data solutions. I request you to like my videos and subscribe to my channel for more notifications around similar content. Just before we start with this session, always remember we have to outwork everyone, and that is the only way that we can clear multiple certifications in a very short span of time. So let's jump to the questions. So you design data engineering solutions for a company. A project requires analytics and visualization of large set of data. The project has the following requirements: notebook scheduling, cluster automation, Power BI visualization. So what are the key three requirements? These are three key requirements. Now let's look at the options. Option A suggests AWS Badge. So Azure Badge. So this is Azure Badge. You run large-scale applications. You can schedule compute-intensive tasks. So what are the use cases of batch? These: financial risk modeling using Monte Carlo simulations, VFX 3D image, image analysis, so on. So batch is definitely not used for these three. Let's look at the second option, Azure Stream Analytics. So this is just like middleware or Kafka service. You can manage real-time analytics service. It helps you analyze and process fast-moving streams of data. So stream use cases is like you can plug streams to transform the data. You can connect it with IoT. So IoT sends the data via streams, and via streams you can store it in a database, or you can do some real-time analytics using Power BI. So the purpose is very different. It cannot be used for these three. It can only be used probably for, it is not, can it cannot be used for Power BI visualization alone. We have to look at notebook scheduling and cluster automation also. Let's look at third option, Azure ML Studio. Using ML Studio, you can, you know, without much of code, mostly using GUI, you can create your machine learning routines. Okay. You have designer available here. You can drag drop. You don't have to write much of code or no code at all, and you can create your routines. Hence, C is also not our option because it cannot fulfill these three. Fourth option, Databricks. So in Databricks, you do have clusters and you can put some automation here. Okay. How you can put the automation? Azure Bricks job scheduler can create job cluster, and you can create cluster using UI, CI and REST APIs. You can create clusters which will auto terminate if there is no activity for a few minutes. You can create cluster for auto scaling, auto sizing. You can schedule a notebook using Databricks clusters, using Databricks. And these are the notebook formats supported: Scala, Py, SQL, R. So in the notebook, you write programs which will work on those clusters. So first thing we do is attach the notebook to a cluster. Now, Power BI visualization. So Power BI can connect to Databricks. Here, what we have to do is create a Databricks connection, and then these are the steps we can use to connect and then create Power BI reports. So with HD Insight, notebook scheduling option is not there. You can use notebooks, run your programs, but scheduling option is not there. So cluster automation, this feature is not available in HD Insight. So if you see here, with HD Insight, you have to use Azure Automation Service. This is a separate service. This is not within HD Insight. Using that, you can create scripts that run in the cloud and manage Azure resources on demand on a schedule. Okay. And this article describes how to create PowerShell to create and delete Azure Insight clusters. Basically, this is using Azure Automation, how to do it. So you see here, Azure Automation, this is a new service in Azure that allows you to automate your Azure management tasks, and it helps in orchestration, actually. Orchestration and, automate your task management. These are the two purpose. So SD Insight doesn't have this. So with SD Insight, you have to use Azure automation. Now here you see visualization using Power BI, it is possible. You know, Power BI can connect to Azure SD Insight and produce reports. So SD Insight, out of these three options, it fulfills only Power BI visualization. Notebook scheduling feature is not there, and cluster automation feature is not there. Hence, the correct answer here is Azure Databricks. Let's look at this question. You plan to migrate data to Azure SQL database. So you are planning to migrate your data to a Azure SQL database on cloud. The database must remain synchronized with updates to Microsoft Azure and SQL Server. If there is any update to either Azure or SQL Server, your database should remain synchronized with those updates. Means patches and etc. Installation of patches etc. should happen automatically with any new changes. You need to set up the database as a subscriber. What should you recommend? So the keyword here is synchronized, and let's see the options. See, Data Factory is an ETL tool, so it will not help you in this regard. SQL Server data tools. Let's look at this. So this tool is used to build SQL Server relational databases. It will not keep it in sync. Okay, this is a different tool. Data Migration Assistant helps you with migration of data and databases from on-premises to cloud. So this is not the answer. Now this option where it says SQL Server agent, so this is the option. Let's look at this option. So here you can clearly see this agent is actually is a service, Windows service that executes scheduled administrative tasks. Like if any threshold is crossed, then alerts will be sent on emails. So let's scan to the last option, SQL Server Management Studio. So if you see this Management Studio works with SQL Server, all version supported SQL database, SQL Manage Instance, Synapse Analytics. What does this do is, it is an integrated environment for managing any SQL infrastructure. Okay. And if you see here, use this tool to deploy, monitor and upgrade the data tier components. So this upgrade happens through this tool also. And the latest release is 18.8. Our question still says 17.9. The latest release has also come. Hence, option E is the right answer. So let's look at the next question. You are designing a real-time stream solution on Azure Functions. What is Azure Function? Let's see. Azure Function is a serverless compute. In AWS world, you have Lambda. Similar to that, you have Azure Functions here. So it does the same as your virtual machine, but it is serverless. There is no server. It runs the functions and then does, and there is no, all resources are deallocated, serverless. Now, if you see these options, there are various options. What we need to first look at is what is app service plan and consumption plan. So here you have these plans, consumption plan. For example, here in this case, what we do is the billing is based on the number of executions. The key here is what is a consumption plan. In here, the Azure Functions hosts are dynamically added or removed based on the number of incoming events. Okay, so it scales automatically. That is the key. In the consumption plan, the scaling is done automatically based on events. So what does the question say? Scaling must occur automatically. Does it match with what we read now? Scales automatically. Okay, it matches. If scaling happens automatically, then will the cost be minimized? Yes, because when more resources are needed, scale out will be done. If not, then scale in will be done. So costs are also minimized. Perfect for us. Now, what is happening is new blocks must be processed with a little delay as possible. That means a trigger is needed, right? So we have consumption plan and we have event grid trigger and block trigger. So what we read on the consumption plan, based on events, this will work. So dynamically added or removed based on incoming events. In dedicated app service plan, app service plan is also called dedicated plan. What happens is you have to manually scale out by adding more VM instances. But question says scaling must occur automatically. Hence, option A and D are eliminated. Now we have to choose between B and C. This is B and C. Let's look at what are these event grid and block triggers. Now here, what happens is In a nutshell, there will be an Azure blob storage. This is Azure blob storage, and it will be feeding to the Azure functions. So whenever there are files, which there are new files or updated files. So this is new blobs must be. So whenever there are new files, it should get triggered. So how should it get triggered? Using blob trigger or event trigger? Now what does event grid does? It sends triggers. So it will send HTTP request to notify you about the events to the publishers. And what can be a publisher? An example publisher in this case is an Azure blob storage account can be a publisher. Okay, so if there is a blob upload or deletion, that is considered as an event. Okay, and then it will send. So event handlers receive and process events. Azure Functions is one of several services that have built-in support for handling event grid events. So first, let's understand what is an event grid. So this allows you to easily build applications with event-based architecture. Like something happens, then some functions has to be triggered. So you have to first subscribe to this. For example, your blob storage can subscribe to this, and once there is a new file coming, it will publish it as an event, like storage blobs, resource groups, etc. So will it work for us? Yes, it should work, because consumption plan with the use of event grid trigger, that can still, what will happen is whenever there is a new blob which is sent, so the Azure blob storage will connect with event trigger. It will create an event, and then Azure functions will get triggered based on that event. So let's look at blob trigger. See, blob trigger, it trig the blob storage trigger starts a function when new or uploaded blob is detected. So this is simple. The blob contents are provided as inputs to the function. So a trigger, it will trigger once a new or uploaded blob is detected. So this is perfect for us, because now both will do the job, but it is asking cost must be minimized. So with event trigger, you have to use event grid. It's a separate service, and that will have additional cost. But with blob trigger, you will not have any additional cost. But then we look at this article, and this article, it says that the storage events, it reacts to the events using Azure Event Grid. It is pushed, and this mechanism is less costly. That's what it says, because it says it does so without the need for complicated code or expensive and inefficient polling services. Okay, so here it's saying it's automatically pushed using Event Grid, and this is less costlier compared to Azure Blob Storage Trigger, because it will poll, and polling works for hybrid between inspecting logs and running periodic maintainer scans. So this polling will be expensive operation, and that's why now both options almost look correct, but how to distinguish? So I saw this documentation. What it says is, this is in the documentation for the storage trigger. So it is doing polling, plus what it's saying is this is on the best effort basis. There is no guarantee that all the events will be captured. So what it means is this requirement, new blobs must be processed with a little delay as possible, with as little delay as possible, and it is a real-time stream solution. So that means is it is a best effort. Maybe in the real-time solution, some blobs would be missed, but when you're designing a solution, you should not design it that way. Now the document itself recommends that you use alternatives like event grid trigger. It works perfectly for blob-only storage accounts. This is what we need. So my final answer would be option B, because it is saying the new blobs must be processed with as little delay as possible. So what happens with blob triggering is, in order to identify if a new blob has come, it will do polling, and that polling takes time. You see, these blobs are scanned in groups of 10,000 with a continuation token used between intervals. So this is a time-consuming exercise. But with event grid, a blob event will come if there is a new upload, and it will activate the event grid trigger. And it will not be a time-consuming exercise, so new blobs will be processed as early as possible. Hence, B is my answer. And in some websites, I did see that someone has put C as an answer, but you see the justifications and the documentation from Azure, and my understanding is it should be B. If you're designing a solution, the solution states these many things, you should adhere to all. So all requirements are fulfilled by option B. Let's look at the next question. A company installs IoT devices to monitor its fleet of delivery vehicles. Data from devices is collected from Azure Event Hub. The data must be transmitted to Power BI for real-time visualizations. So this is what our question is saying. There are delivery vehicles. These are all delivery vehicles. There are IoT devices plugged on it. And these IoT devices are sending data to a hub where the data collection is being done by Azure Event Hub. And now you have to plug Power BI for some real-time analytics. If you see Apache Storm, this is a fault-tolerant open source computation system. You can use Storm to process streams of data in real time with Apache Hadoop. So Storm is cannot be an answer because it is not used for real-time analytics. Let us look at Spark Streaming. So this is also it guarantees input event is processed exactly once. This is a data stream processing. It will not perform analytics on your data streams. For this answer, you need analytics because data must be transmitted to a Power BI for real-time visualizations. See, Stream Analytics is real-time analytics and complex event processing engine. Okay, and Stream Analytics is available on Azure IoT Engine Runtime. What are the scenarios we can use Stream Analytics for real-time IoT, telemetry streams for IoT devices? This is what our answer is talking about. Then click Stream Analytics, Geospatial Analytics on fleet management, driverless vehicles, real-time monitoring of predictive maintenance, etc., and real-time analytics of point of sale. So this is our answer. This is our answer, but Apache Spark in Azure Databricks is a very different utility. It is used to process some sort of data using Spark, but it is not used for this producing real-time visualizations. Or Stream Analytics is the right answer in this case. If your company has an application that uses Azure SQL Database as a data store, the application experiences a large increase in activity during last month of each year. That is, this, in the month of December, due to Christmas, there is heightened activities. You need to manually scale the Azure Database instance to account for the increase in data write operations. Okay, so what should we do? So in this case, like scale up using Elastic Pools to distribute resources. So this is a problem statement that we are trying to answer. Manually scale the Azure SQL Database instance to account for the increase in write operations. How will you manually scale this? Which scaling method you should use? Scale up by using Elastic Pools. So you see, scaling up the Elastic Pool up or down is done dynamically, automatically. There is no manual scaling needed. So option B, sorry, option A is wrong. Let's look at option B. Scale out by sharding the data across the database. Sharding is partitioning. It will not help you with scaling up. It is just partitioning of data for easy access and performance. So B cannot be an answer. Let's look at C. Scale up by increasing the database throughput units. So if I look at this option, how do I scale down Azure SQL databases? It says, database offers DTU processing model and vCore processing model. So DTU, what is DTU? So DTU is data transaction unit based processing purchasing model. So C is the right option. Scale up by increasing the database throughput units. So here you're designing Azure SQL Database. You plan to load millions of rows of data into a data warehouse each day. You must ensure that staging tables are optimized for data loading. You need to design the staging tables. So this is our problem statements. You're designing a SQL data warehouse and you are going to load millions of rows of data into the data warehouse each day. You must ensure the staging tables are optimized for data loading in order to load the data efficiently. So let's first understand each of these options. What are these? Let's start with external tables. Now, see, if you see this description, external tables In a nutshell, external tables are used to read from files or write data to files in Azure storage. It's simple. And what can be the data in the storage? The storage can be Hadoop, it can be Azure storage blob or data lake storage. Wherever your files are, you can, you know, suppose in Synapse SQL, in Synapse you can have external table which is actually pointing to these files, some other storage. Hence it is called external table, because it is, you know, pointing you to external data. So this option here is wrong, because you see what's happening is you are talking about staging tables within a SQL data warehouse. So if you are already getting the data there in the staging table, why will you use external tables? There's no purpose of external table here. So we will strike off this option. It's not relevant. Now let's see replicated tables. See, replicated tables in data warehouse. With replicate tables, the data is available on all compute nodes, hence data movement is eliminated. So what it says is, suppose you are firing queries which are across tables, okay, and data is distributed differently, then in order to join the data, produce it, do some aggregation, etc., there will be data movement to complete the query. Here what you are saying is, if you use replicate table, the data movement is not there. The data is in compute nodes. So if you have small dimension tables, use replicated tables instead of round robin. Now since we have discussed round robin, now we have just bought this topic, let's look what is round robin table. So there is a concept of distributed table. So a distributed table appears as a single table, but the rows are actually stored across 60 distributions. The rows are distributed with hash or round robin algorithm. Okay, hash distributed tables improve query performance on large fact tables and are the focus of this article. Okay, so round robin tables are useful for improving loading speed. Now, you know, you will have to decide what sort of distributed table you want to use. If you have a very large fact table, use hash distributed tables. But if you are looking at your ETL jobs, should load the data very fast and use round robin tables. Now when we were looking at round robin, we got the key, right? Optimize for data loading. And what did we see there in the documentation? We saw improve data loading. So round robin table is our answer. So we got our answer, which is option A, round robin distributed table. So this is a question. You plan to store 100 GB of data for some line of business. Okay, so the data volume is 100 GB and you need to recommend a data storage solution. And the solution should minimize your storage costs. Okay, and there is another important information. It is a storage solution for a database. Okay, and it is not a blob storage, it's a database. This is also a keyword. So database, and the growth is up to 50 terabyte it is expected to grow. So right now you are planning to store 100 GB, but you should have capacity for 50 terabytes. Okay, and usage pattern is this: single updates and reporting, singleton inserts, etc. So these are the solutions that they have given, storage solutions, and we have to choose which one is fine. So let's start with option D. This states SQL database hyperscale. Let's look at hyperscale. So if you see your Azure SQL database, it has three tiers: general purpose, hyperscale, and business critical premium. Now if you see hyperscale, it supports 100 terabytes of database size. Good for our question? Yes, because it is asking for a 50 terabyte capacity, and hyperscale is competent enough to work with 100 terabytes. So this seems to be our answer, but we should scan other options. Let's see SQL data warehouse. Now SQL data warehouse, if you search, the data warehouse size is in 1 to 4 terabyte range, so it will not help for 50 terabytes. So this cannot be an answer. So we will strike this through. Now let's look at Cosmos DB that uses Gremlin API. Now if you search for this for now, you see the maximum total storage per account is 10 GB. Okay, this is the Cosmos DB free limits. And if we get into the details, if you see here, it says maximum storage across items per logical partition is 20 GB. Not good for 50 terabyte storage. Let's look at Elastic Pools. So Azure SQL Database Elastic Pools, what is the capacity? If you see this documentation, it says the max storage per pool. Okay, and the max storage you can see is around like in this 2 terabytes. Hence, we have to strike this out as well. Now let's look at Cosmos DB that uses Gremlin APIs. Now what we're talking about here is singleton inserts. For Cosmos DB, it has unlimited capacity for, I think, from a storage standpoint, but then it has different instances of the database. So it's good for, you know, batch style of inserts. But if you talk about single inserts, that means that's a single instance of a database. And a single instance of a database cannot handle 50 terabytes in Cosmos DB. Hence, we'll strike out this as well. So the only option that looks feasible here is Azure SQL Database Hyperscale. Now let's look at this question. So, blah, 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 this first few lines, this is how it appears in the exam. But the actual question will start from here. You plan to store delimited text files, okay, in a data lake storage account that will be organized into department folders. You need to configure data access so that the users see only the files in their respective department folder. From a storage account, so that's the solution that they have given. From the storage account, you enable a hierarchical namespace and you use RBAC. Does this meet the goal? Okay, I've already highlighted the answer no, but let's look into details of this. Now let's look at first data lake storage account. It is not saying which version V1 V2. So assume it is data lake storage Gen 2 because that is the latest one. See, the keyword here is they want to arrange folders, one folder for one department, and inside the folder files will be there, and only people in that department should be able to access their department files. So the level of granularity of the control is at a very low level, and that means at the file level. So what the solution they have given is enable hierarchical namespace, which is correct. Hierarchical namespace you should enable for, you know, this folder kind of department folder structure. You should enable it. But RBAC is role-based access control. So RBAC gives you higher level control. For example, you have a storage account, so it will give you a coarse grain access. Let's see the difference between RBAC and ACL. So RBAC will give you coarse grain access to the storage account data, such as read or write access to all the data in a storage account. So what does RBAC allow you to do? It allows a user to manage all resources in a resource group, but or it allows one user to manage virtual machines in a subscription and another user to manage virtual networks. So if you see ACLs, it provides fine-grained access, such as write access to a specific directory or a file, and that is exactly what we need here. So if you see our question, it says, you know, you need to configure access so that the users can only see the files in the respective department. This is exactly what we need. So ACL, this should be done through ACL and not through RBAC. Hence, the answer is no. Now we look at the same question, but the solution is different. From the storage account, you disable the hierarchical namespace and then use RBAC. So like we saw in the previous question, we have to enable the hierarchical namespace. Why? Because it says the account will be organized into department folders. That's why you need hierarchical namespace. And now RBAC, like we saw last time, This should be achieved through ACL. RBAC will give you much higher level control at the account level, but here you need control at the department folders and the files level. So the answer is no. So same question, but a different solution. From a storage account, you enable hierarchical namespace, which is right, and you use ACL, which is also right. So hence the answer is yes. So we need a hierarchical namespace. Why? Because it's mentioned here, we have to organize it into department folders. And why ACL? ACL, because you need a very fine granular access to the files in the respective department folders. So we are towards the fag end of the video number 2 of this series. Please like my videos. It gives me a lot of motivation to keep publishing such content. And please subscribe to my channel. It's a sincere request. Please subscribe to my channel, because it's a big motivation for me to keep posting such videos. So just before we sign off, an important quote: work every waking hour to achieve your goal, because this is the only way that you have to succeed in life and achieve your goals. Set monster size goals and work every waking hour to achieve those goals.